That's okay, you're not blotted in anything. First girl was killed, and her body was not found for 30 days. And two boys were walking along, and they thought they saw, in Michigan, farm country, and they thought that they saw a deer in a state of decomposition. And they got closer and smelled bad. They looked, and they saw a human ear, called the police. So she was the first one. Her name is Mary Fleischer. And her body was terribly abused and mutilated. And then 30 days out in the Michigan outdoors left the site, the worst site that these policemen had ever seen. But it barely made the newspaper. 2 weeks before, the Detroit riots had occurred, and that's where all the press was. So, of course, there was mention in the local papers and whatnot, but nobody, they hadn't found the body or anything. So 30 days later, they do find it. And after one article, that's it. Nothing else is said about it. One policeman in particular went to the Fleischer family and said, you know, if we don't catch this guy within the next 30 days, he will kill again within the next year. Almost to the day, a year later, somebody called Joan Schell is killed. She was hitchhiking to Ann Arbor from Ypsilanti at night, and three guys pick her up in a car. Her roommate was standing with her. She was going to catch the last bus, which zoomed by. What am I gonna do? My boyfriend is, you know, Ann Arbor, he's expecting to see me. He's gonna be off of work from the hospital, etc. So she sticks her thumb out. Three guys pull up. Oh yeah, we can, where are you going? We're going to Ann Arbor. Oh, okay, yeah, we're going to Ann Arbor. Well, they pick her up. Lack of judgment there. And she, instead of the car going this way to Ann Arbor, it takes a left and then a right, and then it disappears. And the roommate's saying, this isn't right. Well, at about midnight, the boyfriend calls and says, you know, where's Joan? Well, she left an hour and a half ago with three guys. Well, the flags went up and they called the police, and then there was a search for her, and she was found 3 days later along the side of the road, stabbed quite a few times. And that's basically how it went. I don't know that if I go through all seven of them, I won't be able to say a whole lot more, and I'd like to say more about the murder, and not so much about the girls. His MO, John Norman Collins' MO, was familiarity. He had to be within his comfort zone. So most of these girls were killed within a 5 or 10 mile radius, and bodies dumped within a 5 or 10 mile radius. He was a prowler, a peeping Tom, a rapist, self-admitted rapist. He dumped these bodies in rural areas where they could be found. The first one was off on a farm, but the others were put right off to the side of the road or put in a compromising position. You know, just one last humiliation. And it was very difficult because there were two murders and three murders and four murders and five murders, and the police were no closer to having a prime suspect. Everybody was a suspect. I was a suspect, and then I looked like the guy, and if I could have this thing working, I'd show you. Get my work cut out for me. So anyway, he dropped all the bodies within a triangular drop zone, and he just had absolutely no regard for womanhood at all. I firmly believe that he did not care a whole lot for his mother, but that's another part of the story I may not have time to tell. But The suspect, he had a car to transport the bodies in, and he had a motorcycle. He'd often pick the girls up on a motorcycle. Hey, you want to go for a ride? He had short hair in 1967, 68. You know, people, boys were wearing their hair long and whatnot. And he was old school. You know, he dressed up all the time, very neat. But that was like his sheep's clothing. You know, he would try to make himself be as acceptable, as normal as possible. And he had a great personality. He could talk these girls into the car, onto the motorcycle, and take them to their apartment, his apartment, and then usually he would try to have his way with them. And if he could, then there was no big deal. If he didn't, you know, he was a competitor. He was an angry guy, and he was very strong. He was a weightlifter. And these girls didn't have a chance with him. He was quick, efficient, overkill, mutilation, evidence of necrophilia in a couple of cases, and he took trophies from the girls. And for a long time, the police thought he had a foot fetish and a shoe fetish, and they put a lot of their focus on that. It turned out to be spurious, but they didn't know who they were looking for or how to entrap this guy. Now, keep in mind, this is before the computer databases, and police worked out of cardboard boxes in the trunks of their cars with Xerox copies of police reports and so on. It was not that easy to catch these guys, especially this particular one. He went for 2 years, and what finally did him in was his arrogance. The last girl he picks up on the motorcycle, he takes to his uncle's house. He was, the uncle was on vacation with his family, so John was taking care of the dog. But he was also taking girls to the house, and I've talked to two other girls who he did not kill, who were in that house. And for whatever reason, the timing wasn't right, the mood didn't strike him. But on this third one, he killed her in the basement. His uncle turns out to be a Michigan State policeman. Talk about chutzpah. So he kills her in the basement, and he looks on the floor, basement floor, and he sees these little spots, drips, and he thinks, oh, blood. So he looks on the shelf, and he gets a spray can of black paint, and of course, when the family gets home, the wife comes down to wash some clothes in the basement. She says, what's this paint? She yells up to her husband, hey, get down here. What'd you leave this mess down here for? And he looks, I didn't do that. And as it turns out, he goes back to work, and his boss tells him, your nephew is our prime suspect in this murder. He's a guy who just got back from vacation. He hears that news. So he goes home. He really doesn't know if he should tell his wife or whatever. And so he goes down there with one of his policeman buddies, and they get a knife, and they scrape some of the stuff off. And they find out, they take it to the lab, and they find out that it's not blood. It's varnish. So Collins made the mistake that it was blood painted. Yet if he would have left it alone, probably they wouldn't have seen it for 2-3 days, a week, 2 weeks, or whatever. But, you know, give it 7 or 8 blotches of spit and going in a trail towards the dryer. And so they called in the Michigan State Police anyway to do a full search of this basement. And they found hair, little hair. She, wife of Sergeant Lyke, cut her kids' hair down there. They had 3 small boys. And some of the hair got under the dryer. And what does that have to do anything with any of this? And again, I'm cutting to the chase, I've used it four times, so I'm trying not to be so redundant. They found during the autopsy of this young woman that her underpants were stuffed up inside of her. And what do you think was found in that underwear? The hair. The hair. So that was the most contentious part of the trial that took place because, again, we didn't have the miracle of DNA analysis and all of the new forensic things that are out there. And so it was a very contentious part of the case. It could have lost the case, and then Collins would have been a free man to do whatever he wanted to do. But that's the basic aspect of the story. His methodology puzzled police before they could identify even two or three suspects. They didn't have anybody. These girls were beat. Some were stabbed. Two were shot. Several were strangled. And so the MO is different, and that made it difficult for the police. Five different police departments, by the way, bumping into each other. Weapons, hunting knives, 22 caliber, high standard revolver, electrical cords, victim's undergarments. One was found with some stuffed in her throat. Caustic liquid, bleach, they think. Tree branches, rocks, and one girl had survived a terrible strapping, didn't survive, she eventually was killed, but I don't think she was killed from the strapping, but he took a belt that had a big buckle on it and just hit her so bad that there were welts all up and down her body. And what happened with that particular girl is that what I think happened is that he took her off into the back country and tried his best with her. And this is a girl who had taken karate lessons and she was pretty good. And I of course wasn't there, I don't know. But I believe that she must have landed a blow in the groin area or something to totally anger him. And she got the worst of the beatings. And I won't go into the details, they're in my book. Excuse me. Behavior during the crimes, the victims were often bound, raped, but not all of the girls had seminal fluid inside of them. So that caused problems with the lab reports and the scientific aspect of the case. He would torture them, humiliate them. Part of his behavior before the crimes, of course, stalking, but overkill. And I think I already mentioned that there was evidence of necrophilia in a couple of instances. So this guy was not a person that you would want to have anything to do with. Yet, he has the ability to inspire loyalty and confidence in people. It's uncanny. And he is maintaining from day one he didn't kill anybody. But when you start looking into the case as deeply as I have, you find out that coincidence, maybe you have one coincidence, but when they start getting 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 coincidences, but he didn't have anything to do with any of it, it's pretty hard to believe. He was convicted of one murder, the last murder, with the hair and the underpants. And he got life in prison, no possibility of parole, but he could be pardoned by a sitting Michigan governor. I don't think that's likely. Now, he's been in prison for 48 years. He and I are not what we would call good friends. I've written him a number of times. And he did write me one time, and he was upset that I had turned his cousin against him. He had one last living blood relative in Canada, and John was trying to engineer an international prisoner exchange. He was born in Canada, but he, at 5 years old, he comes to the United States, 4 or 5, and he is, you know, in America, a citizen, Americanized, as a naturalized citizen, whatever. And so he's lived his whole life, most of his life, in Michigan. His grandparents, his mother, his brother, his sister, everybody knows all the schools he went to. He's got one relative, blood relative. And so John sees this as his last chance to find somebody to sponsor him in Canada. He had tried this about 20 years before with this cousin of Collins, with the cousin's father, and the whole thing fell apart. The publicity was bad, and the Michigan police or prison system decided that they were not going to sign the final paperwork to send him. So 20 years later, he tries it again, and this young guy, he's 40 years old now, but he had been writing his cousin in prison for many, many years, and then he quit for 10 years, and he started up again for some reason. And John Collins figured, this is my last chance. So he tried to get his cousin to sponsor him, and he would have, if he would have sponsored him, Collins would be a free man in Canada today, because they have different sentencing laws than we have in the United States. So a life sentence is basically considered, you know, if you do 15 years of good time, you can get put on a work release program, and a supervised program. Anyway, it didn't happen. He, the cousin got so upset, and he saw on the internet my blog, and I've been blogging about my research for the last several years, and after he read several of them, he called me and he says, well, you know, I'm John Norman Collins' Canadian cousin, and would you be interested in talking to me? Well, she said, yeah. And not only did I develop a friendship with this guy, he gave me about a dozen of Collins' prison letters. And so I have a insight now into who he is from reading his letters and reading between the lines. And sometimes you have to read between the lines. But remember, he's still in prison. Everything that goes into and out of that prison is read. You know, so there's little codes and different things that the prisoners use. But the police aren't as stupid as a lot of the criminals credit them to be. And so he was shot down twice on this Canadian transfer. He is extremely upset with me, but I mean, what are you going to do? You know, he's up in Marquette. You know, Michigan is the only state you can hold your hand up and show where you live. Yes, the Mitten State. And then Upper Peninsula, while the high security prison in Michigan, state prison, is Marquette Branch Prison. Marquette is right up there on Lake Superior, and it's a miserable place to be in a cell. So he has not had a good time of it, nor should he. But he still maintains that he's innocent. I'm jumping in the story, I'm flying by the seat of my pants now. The third murder, her name was, the third victim, her name was Joan, no, Jane Mixer. Jane Mixer was killed and laid out at a cemetery. She was basically clothed, but she wasn't quite in the disarray that all the other girls were. So some of the cops said, you know, this one doesn't look like it's one of Collins's. But for 30 years, everybody credited Collins with making, you know, that third, killing that third woman. 30 years later, now we have DNA. One of the state police who worked on the original case, and it always bothered him about the Mixer murder. So he got, there was some DNA evidence that they had, and it took about a year or two before you know, they could get the, all the, you know, the protocols done and whatever. I'm not a forensic scientist, so I don't know why it took so long, but it took over a year. And then a cold, it came back a cold, what they call a cold hit, meaning that one name came up, bang. And it was somebody nobody had ever heard of. His name was Gary Earl Leiterman. And Gary sold pharmaceuticals and also stole prescription blanks and was going around to different pharmacies and getting drugs and selling them, probably. He said, oh, I hurt my back and this and that, and I get to do it, you know. But the case found him guilty. So the relevance to my story, to my case, is now the shadow of doubt looms large for him. And he has his sycophants who write him, and he emails, and he can email. And so he starts putting out this, oh, I'm innocent, I never did this, see, they said I killed this one. And the younger people who didn't live through this, you know, people 20 years later, were willing to give this guy the benefit of the doubt. So the internet was just full of, this guy was railroaded by an overzealous prosecutor. There was a rogue cop that was out to get him, and you know, all of this kind of nonsense. And you can imagine, you know, we all know about the internet. You put something out there, and some things just die on the vine, but other things have legs. And you can't control where that story's going or where that information is going. So there was a growing body of people who were willing to say, hey, this guy is probably innocent. Well, I came across some of the websites for John Collins and saw some of this stuff, and it personally upset me because the story had never been told as a cozy mystery, in one of the genre areas, a cozy mystery. There's nothing cozy about this story at all. And the man who wrote the thing, it was 5 years after the murders occurred, I mean 5 to 7 years, it was a 2 year span. He took the notes that one of my Eastern Michigan University professors had for the case, because he was writing his book too. And he had been in every single day in the courtroom. He's a university professor, and the case took place during the summer, so he was able to be there. And so he had been working on his book. Edward Keyes, who wrote with Robin Cook, the French Connection, came into town, and the Ann Arbor News did an article saying, Edward Keyes is in town to research and write a book on John Norman Collins. Well, my professor went, I've been writing a book on John Norman Collins. I can't even get arrested in this town. So he gives a call to the Ann Arbor News and ends up getting in touch with Edward Keyes, and he tells him who he is, and he says, you know, I'd like to work with you if you don't mind. So that's what happened, and Edward Keyes wrote a book called The Michigan Murders, which is not a really a great title, but I don't have time to go into why that's not a great title. But The Michigan Murders, and he wrote it from just no real retrospect. It was only 5 years. So he basically went with what the police had written in the police reports and from newspapers. Essentially the same material that many years later that I had to use the Freedom of Information Act to get. So I read this guy's book 3 times. First time I read it, you know, many years ago, okay, I liked it, but I wasn't upset with it at all. I wasn't that familiar with the story. But as I became more familiar with it, it was apparent the guy changed all the names of the victims and the names of the murderer. And the legacy of that was to leave confusion in the community, two communities, Ann Arbor and Ypsilanti. because the people would read this book and the names were changed, and then there was another book that came out written by a state policeman. He too changed their names, different names, and it was just a muddle. And I realized something, that there was a vacuum. This is what authors look for, an area that's basically virgin, use the expression, virgin territory. This story had never been written using the facts, using hindsight of people who lived through this story. I've talked to police. I can't even tell you how many people I've interviewed, and I have a researcher too. He and I talked to everybody who ever knew John Collins that we could find, and many of them would talk to us. Some would talk to us, but not give us their names. And then there were those that 50 years later are still frightened to death of him and are so traumatized. And I figured, somebody's gonna write this book. It might as well be me. You know, I'm retired, a former teacher, and I always wanted to be a writer. Well, I wrote a book. This one took me 2 years. Zug Island, a Detroit riot novel, and it's about some of the underlying causes of the riot and attitudes between the suburbs and the inner city attitudes and so on. And so this took me 2 years, and I was looking for another project, and I was a hippie, and I guess you could say that. You could say that and be telling the truth. So I did all the hippie things that hippies did, and I still went to college and, you know, did my homework and said my prayers and ate my vitamins, but it was just coming from a different ethos back in those days. And I thought, I'm gonna write a book about the 60s and all the drugs and one thing or another, and I'm gonna call it The Psychedelic Pioneers. And after writing 30 pages of that, I decided that I had a great title, but a crappy book.
Scary.
Terrible. But it also struck me in the next thought that the story was one block down the street from me that had not been adequately written. Even to this day, it has not been. I just wrote a book. I hope it's adequately written. People are telling me that it is. But it's amazing because there are so many people who have not been able to talk about this with their relatives or even just to come to grips with it themselves. And since I've been blogging about this, and now that the book is out, I've been getting all kinds of acclamation about the book and how it's helped them to deal with their frustration and all of that. Yeah.
I'm hearing a lot about all the people you talked to, and one thing I'm not hearing is that you didn't talk to him.
Well, I tried to write him a number of times, but he wouldn't talk to me. He's only going to talk to people. Yeah. He only talks to people that he can manipulate or that he feels he can manipulate. And I have met quite a few of these people over the years, and I've got 4 different people who've given me his letters because he's outworn his welcome with them. And I'd fly in just to get up there to talk to him. But I talked to an FBI profiler, and Mark Zaprick is his name. He's on television a lot. And I was talking to him about trying to see Collins, and he says, what do you want to do that for? And I said, he says, no, to find out information. Why else? He says, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. He says, you're going to have to go see him 4 or 5 times before he even decides that he wants to lie to you. And I thought about it.
Because the guy is a
compulsive liar. He said things about me in these letters. He didn't know I was reading these letters, you know. And he called me, my nickname is the fornicator, Fournier, yes. So he picked up on that.
He doesn't know about mathematics, obviously. A
fornicator's
name.
Yeah. And he was just looking for any way to, you know, slight me. But he was saying how I was a thug, and me and my researcher, a couple of gangsters, and we're threatening people for information, and only 3 or 4, you know? No. A sociopath, a liar, compulsive thief.
Charming, non-empathic at all.
No, and he could go kill somebody and go home, and I would imagine have a sound sleep afterwards. That was something that crossed my mind, too. Why should I, you know, once you get that image of something, you know, or somebody says that one thing that really upsets you, that's what you remember. You don't forget it. But basically, I've got so many other things to talk about, and I don't, are we good on the time? Yeah.
Question and answer period would be great.
Yeah, okay.
I'm sure we have a lot of